energy per charge. This acceleration potential, we know it here because we command the instrument. And the speed inside here, the time of flight chamber, we just replace it by the length of the time of flight chamber over the time of flight. The time of flight also we measure. So that's how we get an estimation of the mass per charge. Now for this kind of, so this is a particular for this, what we call straight through. For this straight through, you see it directly here that the mass per charge, it depends on the energy per charge. And so it depends if the ions have higher energies, then their time of flight will be lower. And so the mass per charge really depends here on the energy per charge and also on the direction of the entrance of the ions, because they can be diffused and they can be detected in at the edges of this microchannel plate, and this can affect the mass per charge. Now, the very particularity and actually the strength of this instrument is this other part, the effect of the linear electric field here. And not all actually the mass spectrometers have this linear electric field. Why this is very important? Because now if we talk about these positively charged ions, how do we calculate the mass per charge? Here we can reduce the problem to a harmonic oscillator. And if we write as well, from the equation we have the mass times, so the acceleration, it will be equal to, well, minus the charge constant K times Z, which is the distance of here, the reflection. And if we divide by the mass, then we obtain this relation. And here you can note the angular frequency omega squared. And from this omega squared equal to this kind of ratio, we can obtain this formula. Here, T prime is the half period of for the oscillation, and which represent as well the time of flight that is detected in the upward detector. And so we have a direct relation relating the mass per charge to the time of flight without any dependence on the energy. So, and this is very actually weird. I mean, maybe it's difficult to imagine that whatever is the energy, let's say, of the oxygen that enters the instrument, it will always be, if it leaves, if it's positively charged, it will always be detected at the same time of flight, independently of the energy of the ions that enters. Now, let me show you some examples. So this is actually observations made in the lab. So we send a beam of ions toward the instrument to calibrate it and to see if the linear electric field part works very well and the straight through part works very well. So we send a beam of helium plus ions and also potassium ions, K plus, at different energies, at 1 keV and 4 keV in red. And you see that for the linear electric field, the ones that are reflected upward, whatever is the energy, the helium plus ions, they are always observed at the same time of flight. The x-axis is the time of flight of the ion. And it's the same for the potassium. So the mass per charge does not depend on the energy. However, if we look at the straight through data, so the neutrals or the negatively charged ions, we see a difference between the spectra. The larger energy, so the red lines, will have lower time of flight because we'll have, they have higher energies. And also, for the potassium ions as well. Another difference you can see is that the spectra for the linear electric field, they are almost kind of Dirac, actually. They are very well resolved in mass. However, for the straight through ions, because they depend on the energy and the direction, they will be diffused, actually. And the spectra presents some tails like this. So this, the first part, the left, the linear electric field would give a very high mass resolution. well, much better than the straight through. However, if you look on the y-axis here, it shows the counts. The counts are much lower, 10 order of, here we have maybe 100 counts, and here we have, yes, 1,000 counts. So most of the ions that enter the time of flight, they actually leave as neutrals or negatively charged, and only some of them, they will be reflected upwards. Okay, I don't have much time. Maybe I can continue later tomorrow if it's okay. Yeah. Okay, so this is why the mass resolution is very important. I will just finish on the mass spectrometer. Why this is very important to have a very high mass resolution. So here also I will show you a comparison between, so this is actually ion beam sent in the lab. So this is the total ions measured by the instrument in comparison to simulated data using simulations. And if we send different ion beams, so the colors here are not very well shown, but helium plus nitrogen, the carbon or sodium ions, the first panels are the straight through, the second panel are the linear electric field. And you can see at least a very well consistency between the simulated data and the observations in the lab. It's not very clear here. But the time of flight, they coincide very well. And also the main point here, if we take, for instance, this is the oxygen carbon ions, and if we take the carbon, oxygen, and nitrogen, these three curves, you see that the curves overlap. And if in the data, if we have a curve like this, then we will have an overlap between the carbon ions and the oxygen and the nitrogen. And it will be very difficult sometimes to distinguish between these three ions. However, if we have Dirac kind of spectra, we can very well and validate or confirm if we actually, because there is no overlap between the carbon ions is just one spectra and the nitrogen as well. There is no overlap between the spectra. Now, if I have maybe 2 minutes, or I will just show you, actually, it's the first time that I show this in public. I will show you the latest observations that we measured from the mass spectrometer, MSA, during the second Mercury flyby of Bepi Colombo. So Bepi Colombo flew by Mercury in June, 23rd of June, so a couple of months ago. And during this flyby, so here, maybe there was a movie just to show you. For the first time, like even MESSENGER, so if you may know, MESSENGER was another orbiter that, it's a NASA mission that flew by the planet. And for the first time, we were at an altitude very close to the planet at about 198 kilometers, so very close to the surface of the planet. And we could, these are some actually video made from different pictures taken from the camera on board the spacecraft that when we saw the surface of the planet and the different craters here. But other than the images, we could perform as well some in situ measurements. And this is just here, the trajectory of the spacecraft. And here I'm just showing you, despite the lots of data gaps, the y-axis is the energy per charge as a function. Because we are in a cruise phase. The short answer is that we are in cruise phase. We are operating in low mode. And so we have lots of telemetry loss, loss of data because of telemetry reasons. This is the short answer. and we could measure the ion along this trajectory. Not from these data, but from the electron data, we could also identify different boundary crossings, the magnetopause crossing in and out, and the Bauschau crossings once, and then we got in the solar wind. And this structure here is actually foreshock structures that we observed in the solar wind. So I wanted just to show you the time of flight spectra. So this is actually around this line is the closest approach around the planet. And I will show you now two time of flight spectra. One close to the closest approach and another one in the solar wind. And this is what really the data look like of the time of flight spectra. Y-axis is the energy per charge as a function of the time of flight, and the color bar here represents the counts. The red curves represent the theoretical, the dotted curves represent black curves, the theoretical time of flight for different mass per charge values. So we know that the first red curve, black red dotted curve, is a time of flight for mass per charge equal to 1. The second one is mass per charge equal to 2. How do we plot these curves? It's using the formula that I showed you before. And so on. We increase the different mass per charges that would represent actually different ions in the environment. And when we look at the observations, we see, at least from these two plots, that around the closest approach, we have lots of counts actually that overlap very well with the theoretical curve for the mass per charge equal to 1. So now we know that this is this would represent proton ions. The second represents the helium plus ions, and so on. And this one lines would represent this one represents the alpha particles, and this line would represent the helium plus ions. And if we compare between the closest approach and the foreshock region, well, this would be another talk. But we could also identify some helium plus ions and alpha particles around the closest, at least planetary helium plus ions around the closest approach. Now, in addition, and you see these are curved lines, which it's curved, it means that they depend on the energy. Now, in addition to this, we also observe these signatures, which kind of vertical, they are not really curved. And these are actually, we interpret this as related to less protons. What happens is that during the crossing of the carbon foil, the protons will enter as a neutral or positively charged. Now, the neutral will be detected downwards, and the positively charged will be reflected upwards. Now, during this cruise phase, we are not measuring the left protons because we are operating in low mode. And but still, I mean, the instrument is detecting these left protons. But then what happened is that secondary electrons are emitted simultaneously and accelerated downwards. And so they will be detected in the straight through bottom. Okay. Yes. So we have an overlap of indirect left signature of the protons and straight through signatures of the protons. And well, we cannot do anything about this. I mean, these are the data we need to deal with and but try to clean them.
The engineer, not the scientist.
Well, actually, not really, no, because, but yeah, so we need to find a way to clean, to filter this data and to actually. To know the real contribution of the protons, at least from this case. But to be continued tomorrow. Thank you.
Thank you, Linda, for a nice talk. Maybe one question before we start. Honestly, you know that tomorrow afternoon we'll have this informal session with Linda and Saito. If you have more questions, that might be a good one. A couple of announcements. Please pass. What's your announcement for tomorrow, for Wednesday's talk? Just a reminder.
Yeah, reminder. Yes. After 2 o'clock, from 2 to 5, we can take, including evening.
Okay. And this afternoon, we have a poster session. And then one reflection I want to make. It's very healthy and refreshing to see, I mean, Professor Mahajan and I promoted the participation of more women in our college. And it's very refreshing to see the result now that we are here and we have a larger percentage of women participating. And we have also, not just from the participant side, but also from the lecture side, we have very great lecture from people like Lina. And take home messages that when you go back home to your institutions, to your country, to take steps to promote the participation of more women. Because it's a fantastic field.
Yes. Society without women is very bothering.
There is no society without women. Interesting.
Thank you.
Oh, thank you. I hope it was here. Yes, is it off like this? If it's red,
I would like to show this to my daughter. She's been just making the before that you took it's moving pictures.
You think it will be shared or not?
I think we have recordings, slides we can get.
Yes, of course, I will upload them.
That might work.
I was just saying that this pandemic is a lot of questions.
Hi. What did you do on the weekend?
I went to Venice.
Venice?
Yeah.
When?
On Saturday.
Ah, it was yesterday.
No, I stayed there for 2 days. I came back yesterday.
You didn't stay in Venice?
I had a hotel booked in Masquerade.
Say again?
I had a hotel booked in Masquerade, Venice Masquerade.
Yeah.
So I slept there for the night, and then...
Really?
Yeah.
In the station?
Sorry?
Where did you sleep?
Hotel.
Ah, oh, RTA.
Hotel.
In the Westway?
Ah, Westway. I thought you were wearing new shaving wood
for federal.
Yeah, she almost was struggling. But can you please, we can show up from there, just getting the information. I'm trying to make sense, like,
in what field you are.
I work in experimental discipline. So that's why when Mitch was talking about language, so I have done everything. We do it on a regular basis. So that's why I was able to, you know, connect.
Okay, how
do
you measure?
Simulation. Actually, I also do some simulation.
Okay,
I don't know much stuff. I just try to understand.
So I got it your way. Yeah,
and
I
believe that. There are so many things that they tell, but you don't understand.
You know, so
we are starting out now, so we are like, then we should know all.
I want to say that my daughter told me, or that I know, I think you're a human person.
हमने 120 करोड़ साया
Thank you. रिकॉर्डिंग स्टॉप और ऑन करने का